Today we have gathered here, me and my group, we are going to discuss the topic being proactive. So let's start with what is being proactive and how it is effective and how it is going to affect our day-to-day life. There are some tasks that we preponed. We just talk about them, we discuss about them before they are just going to happen. So being proactive means thinking and acting before the anticipate events. It not only reduces haphazardness in your life, making your life more ace-free and more normal, and it is good for everybody. Now, to understand it more betterly, it is good to understand what is reactive. There are two sorts of people we are going to discuss. One is proactive and another is reactive. There are some people who are not ready for the moment. They just react at the very moment time they are put in a situation. They don't first prepare for the situation. When they are put in the situation, they react according to the situation and they keep on somehow huffing or puffing. They keep on scrambling the situation to remain afloat. They are just very much dependent on the situation. If the situation goes wrong, they can just vanish somewhere. So let's take an example. There are two sorts of swimmers, two individual swimmers. One of them is proactive and another one is reactive. The first person, he is going to prepare every situation. They are put in a chopping sea. They will do a situation. The first person will prepare himself. He will learn the various techniques. He will take the various tools with himself in the chopping water. While the other, when he is put in the situation, he will very much in the situation, he will think and he will start panicking. So we can very easily distinguish between the two people. The one who has previously designed the situation and worked according to it, and another person who is, when put in the situation, he is reacting according to this. So let's see what is the differences between the two. Let's get them in the board. Do not blame anything or anyone. Proactive people, they don't just blame the situation. They don't curse the situation that this happened because of this particular reason, this and that. While the reactive people, they keep on influencing, they keep on blaming the external stimuli present around that this happened to me because of environment is not good, because of the situation, everything is not perfect for me, the environment was not perfect for me to work according to it. Behavior is the product of their conscious choice based on values. Behavior is the product of conditions based on feelings. So the proactive person is going to work according to the situation. They will not conscious. They will use their conscious in the very first place. While the reactive person, they are not going to use their conscious. They are going to gather information from the external people. And they are going to, if they are person, they collect information from the people. If someone is reacting in that particular situation, then I am also going to react in this situation, in this manner. They carry their weather with them. Proactive people are those who influence others, while reactive people are those who get influenced themselves. They are still influenced by external stimuli, but this response is value-based choice or response. Reactive people build their lives around other emotions. They just make the situations and they are dependent on other external. So to this, one more thing we always discuss is perception. What is perception? Perception is a situation, a hearing or acting a person gets through his senses. So these are the images that I'm showing of perception. There are some people who are going to get this as a ship, while others are going to consider them as a cloud. Next. These are the pictures. Some will recognize them as faces, while other will recognize them that two individuals are sitting over there. Next. And this is the picture. So some will recognize them as a horses, while other will recognize them as a mountain there. Okay. Archana will carry on.
Hello, everyone. Our next slide is about no one can hurt you without your consent. There are the two factors in this, stimulus and responsive. Stimulus refers to the act which we are going to do. In this, we have to judge about that we do that act or not. So for doing that act, first we have to judge that. So we take the action self-awareness. Self-awareness stand to awareness about the act which we are going to perform. And then imagination refers to the thoughts which comes in our mind before doing any act. And then consciousness and independent will. Independent will means our willingness for doing that act or not. And then the next step is taking the initiative act, or in this we have to decide that act or be acted upon. There are the two factors, resourcefulness and the initiative. Resourcefulness stand for the means and resources and the knowledge which we have gained from others. And initiative means after doing act which we think that this act that we are already and listening to our language. And then next step is reactive language and proactive language. In reactive language, the people think about there is nothing I can do. And the proactive language, and the people who are the proactive in nature, they are like that, let's look at our alternatives. And then reactive language, the people who are about the reactive way, that's just the way I am. And the proactive language, I can choose a different approaches. And the reactive language, he makes me so mad. And the people who are the proactive in nature, I can control my own feelings. And the people who are reactive, they won't allow that. And the proactive people, I can create an effective presentation. And the people who are reactive in nature, I can't. And the people who are in nature, I choose. Thank you.
The next slide is circle of concern and the circle of influence. Excellent way to become more self-aware regarding our own degree of proactivity is to look at where we focus our time and energy. And now we will tell about this some points about the circle of influence. And the inner column shows that circle of influence, and the outer column shows that the circle of concern. Circle of influence, some points are there: our health, our family, our work, our speciality, our emotions. The next slide is difference between the proactive and the reactive. Proactive people focus their efforts on circle of influence, and the reactive people focus their efforts on the circle of concern. And the nature of their energy of the proactive is positive, and the nature of their energy in reactive is negative. Causes of the proactive is concern of influence increases, and in reactive, concern of influences shrink, means decrease. Now we will talk about the direct, indirect, and the no control. Direct control problems can be solved by working our own habits. And direct control problems can be solved by changing our own habits. That is also known as the private victory, as the book refers. Indirect control problems can be solved by changing our method of influence. No control problems can be solved by changing the line on the bottom of our face. It means we should smile genuinely, perfect, peacefully accept and learn to live with them. And the expanding the circle of influence, the important points are: be a better listener, be a better learner, be more loving, or be happy, be a dedicated worker.
So I'm going to tell you how to be proactive. So first of all, to be a proactive, my name is Mohammad Sarim Rizwan. So to be a proactive, you have to look at yourself, ask some questions, self-reflect. For example, if I have an interview, I will look myself in the mirror and ask some questions to myself. And the second thing, when I ask some questions, then I critically examine myself that how I can perform these tasks more efficiently. The third point is try to prevent problems from ever arising. The fourth is develop a mindset that looks to solve problems instead of dwelling on them. And the fifth one is get and stay ahead of less urgent day-to-day tasks. And the fifth one is know which tasks are priorities and which can wait. For example, if I have an interview and if I have an interview at 9 a.m., but I usually go to 9 a.m. at the gym, so I can skip that gym session because I have an interview. So this point says that know which tasks are priorities and which can wait. And the third point, the sixth point is eliminate any task that is unnecessary, and evaluate your procedures and processes as you use them. Look for ways to automate routine tasks, and finally learn something for the sake of learning something. Develop a passion.
Hello everyone, my name is Amit Mishra, and let's see the importance of being productive. Being productive means responsibility for your life and action rather than just watching how things happen. Simple meaning of being productive means backup plan. If you work in anywhere and you lose your job, so have a backup plan for your job. And being productive takes time, since you have to consider your option, be alternative, and make your own decision in order to achieve your goals. A reactive behavior is influenced by the environment and outside forces. In this picture, to be productive, you need to be clear about your goals in life and carry out action to help you achieve the goals. And being productive means anticipating problems, seeking new solutions, and doing our best. Being reactive, on the contrary, means solving problems when they trump of not waiting chance and doing the minimum effort. Akansha will continue.
After seeing the various importance, benefits, and every step how to get proactive, we should know that whether we are proactive or reactive. So if you are looking for some steps to how to notice, how to judge that whether you are proactive or reactive, then these are the some of the tests that you can take while to measure your effectiveness. First one is how we make or keep commitments. How much effort you are making to make your commitments. How much you are very much responsible that you are just, if you are promising someone and you are just carrying out that promise shows how proactive, how much your talk, how much your language means to someone or to yourself itself. How do we handle traffic jams? How irritated, how much patience? It is not about the traffic jam that we are looking for. It is the patience level that we are testing here. And next one is, how do we react to irritate environment? That if people around you, maybe your classmates, maybe your batchmates, if they are very irritating enough, still you can cope up with them, then you are really very much proactive. This is also a measure of being proactive. How do you react to upset relatives? Means if the people around are someone who you really don't want to adopt with, still you are adopting, that is going to show your measure of proactive. How we view our problems. If there are problems, instead of getting irritated, instead of getting a panic about it, how better we are handling the situation shows your proactiveness. Where we focus our energies. So as we discuss in influence, circle of influence and circle of concern. So if instead of focusing on the circle of concern, various circle of concerns, we should, matlab, those topics we are not able to influence, we should focus on the things which are under our control. So if you are focusing on those topics which are under your influence, then it is going to increase your proactive level and also make you more effective. So work on it, and thank you. It is like in the circle of concern, everything falls, like your housing, your loans, your various doctor's prescriptions, everything. So instead of focusing on those things which are not under our control, like government policies or something that irritates external environment, we should focus on the situation that are under our control. So in those things, we should make ourselves captive to those things only. Matlab, we can make ourselves realize, we can make ourselves understood that these particular things are not under our control. Instead of blaming those particular situation, I should focus on things that are under our influence. This is particularly on my mentality level, that I should... No, you should not ignore the situation, but you can make effort to the level you are. If you are a level of a person at a mediocre, you can only focus on middle level. You cannot just focus on the top level. Like, you cannot blame government for changing the policies. We get irritated with various policies, but instead we cope up with them.
My name is Parul Katyar. I, along with my team members, are here to acquaint you all with the habit number one of the 7 habits of highly effective people given by Stephen R. Covey. So if you have any questions throughout, you are most welcome to please ask as we go along. Proceeding towards our presentation, do you all know who was George Bernard Shaw? He was a famous playwright of his own era. So he once stated that in this world, there exist 3 kinds of people. Let's count them. Number one, those who make things happen. Number two, those who see what happens. And number three, those who wonder what happened. Let me ask one question from you guys. So what do you think, what is habit? Anyone? I pardon, what is habit? Yeah, right. A habit is a routine of behavior that is repeated regularly and tends to occur subconsciously. Okay, that's a Wikipedia definition. In a more easier one, says that when we do, when we sum up the knowledge of what to do and why to do with the want or desire to do and the skills so as to how to do, we come up with the term habit. Habits can either create or destroy our future. So it depends upon the nature of habit you all possess in yourselves. To be successful, it is necessary that you choose habits calmly and correctly, the right ones. So we are going to discover one of those habits. The number one habit says that to be proactive. So habit one says that you should have the attitude to take the responsibility of your own actions. You are the creator and the in charge. I would appreciate you guys to please read this silently in your minds and understand what the meaning, understand the meaning it reflects. Moving forward, topics we'll be covering in this presentation includes number one, proactivity defined. Secondly, proactive versus reactive. Third, characteristics of a proactive leader. Fourth, the circle of influence. Fifth, the 5 P's in being proactive. So now I would like to call one of my team member, Parul Raj, to continue with the presentation.
My name is Parul and I will be telling you what this proactive actually means. So let's start with an example. 2 people in the same company, in the same position, may tackle problem in a different way. The first one tries to take charge, launches new initiatives, work hard, while the second one tries to get along, confirms, and keep his head above water. The first person works for consecutive reform, while the second one goes with the flow and passively conducts the business as usual. So we can say that the first person is proactive, while the second is not. So to be proactive means taking control over the things you can control, while forgetting about the things you cannot control. Now, the question is what you can control. So make a list and identify each item in that list as something you can control in the proactive column, while you cannot, and that you cannot control in a reactive column. We'll come to know that only you can control yourself. So the habit number one, that is being proactive, is a fundamental habit. We can choose our actions, but we cannot control our responses that comes that are the consequences of that actions. We do have, however, have the freedom to choose our responses even in the situation in which we cannot control ourselves. So in between stimulus and response, there lies a space. And in that space lies our freedom to choose. We can choose our actions or responses by exercising that freedom. Now the responses which we choose will begin to influence our stimulus, and then we will, at last we'll be knowing, we can determine what will happen to us at the end. So freedom to choose, within the freedom to choose there are 4 human endowments that are self-respect, conscience, independent will, and imaginations. Now moving on to self-awareness. By exercising our self-awareness, we are able to detect, realize, understand the effects that determinism may have on us. Our current behavior can be influenced by our past conditions, but it cannot be determined by our past conditions. And we know that our attributes and responses depends on our paradigm. So by shifting our paradigm, we can change or alter our responses and behavior. Now, coming on to imagination. When we live with our imagination, we are tied to future and something which is finite. And on the other hand, when we live with our memory, we are tied to something which is finite and tied to our past. So imagination is the power of vision. Conscience is a universal value system, moral guidance that is based on the principle as service, kindness, respect, responsibility, etc. Now comes independent will, which allows us to act such that we can be independent of our external influences. This is especially during situation where we may be emotionally charged up. Independent will allows us to choose how we want to respond rather than to let determinism decide for us. Thank you.
The another team member, Raj, for carrying the presentation forward.
You all are now aware of what proactivity means. The opposite of proactivity is reactive. When you are proactive, you make good decisions, choices with a calm attitude. You do things to make sure right things will happen to you and are ready for everything else. Even if things don't go your way, you are calm and composure. But when you are reactive, you could explode at any minute. You are not ready and expect that things happen and they catch you off guard. It is easy to differentiate between proactive and reactive members by the words or language that or she uses. Reactive language says, I have to, I need to, I can't, I haven't time, if only but. But proactive people says, I choose to, I prefer to, I will, yes or no. Proactive people understand that their lives are a function product of their values and feelings. Focus, please focus. Values and feelings, not decisions and conditions. Reactivity is the function of feelings, impulses, moods, and other people's treatment. But proactivity is the capacity to subordinate these two values are based on the principles.
So now that you know how a proactive person is different than a reactive person, let's analyze ourselves and take a look at the actions that we perform in the workplace. Like, are you aware of your surroundings and the events happening around you? Are you participating in them? And if yes, then how are you preparing for them? How are you controlling the events? And what kind of role are you taking? Is it a passive role or an active role? And are you only thinking in terms of present, or do you also look in the future to anticipate the events and prepare for the consequences? Do you only take a decision only when you have to, because it's your job, or because you can do that because you want that thing to happen? And one of the most important thing is, do you have a larger long-term plan? Because if you do not have a plan, or you do not have an idea that what your ultimate goal is, then there's no point in trying. So these were some of the points that we should think about if we are willing to be a proactive person. And as we are willing to be so, let's look at some of the qualities and characteristics of a proactive leader. The first thing is, a leader who is willing to have a long-lasting impact on the organization always go for a proactive role. And they don't wait for the problems to arise before addressing them. Because it does not matter if you are a middle-level manager or a top-level leader, forward thinking is always the best way to manage. And they take responsibility for their management roles, and proactive leaders are great listeners and communicators, and they are highly organized, and they know how to utilize the strength, and they help and inspire other people in becoming a proactive person. And the most important thing is, they don't hesitate in taking help, because it does not matter if you, because no matter how big a leader you are, you are always going to need help, and you should not hesitate in taking it from your juniors or your subordinates. So these were the qualities of a proactive leader. Now Parul will continue.
The circle of concern and the circle of influence. It's a technique for separating lower from higher priorities and growing and gaining ownership for our actions. The first one is circle of concern. Circle of concern contains the things which we are worried and concerned about, and we cannot do anything about them. While on the other hand, the circle of influence contains concerns that we have influence over. Now, again, coming on to the circle of concern. The circle of concern covers questions such as, who will be getting promotion? Who will be the client be purchasing the item from? Will my future-in-law like me? Will my friends be loyal to me always? Whereas on the smaller scale, the circle of influence contain more descriptive forms like, what are the things I could do to ensure that promotion? How could I build the trust so that the client would purchase from me? What are the paradigm for my future-in-law for good choice in a person? And have I been keeping the promises I made to my friends? So from these examples, we can say that reactive people focus on the outer circle, the circle where they could do nothing but complaining, judging, criticizing, and wanted to be understood first, withdrawing from emotional background, etc. On the other hand, the proactive people focus on the inner circle, the circle of influence. This is also where we have to focus our all energy. If we continue working in this circle, that this inner circle, inevitably, then we will be then this circle, that is the circle of influence, will get larger and larger over the time. Thank you.
Now I would like to call upon Raj for further 5 P's in being proactive.
There are 5 key behaviors that the 5 P's involved in being proactive. The number one is predict. In order to be proactive, you must first develop foresight. Proactive people are rarely caught by surprise, learn to anticipate problems and events. The second P is prevent. Proactive people foresee potential obstacles and exert their power to find a way to overcome them before the obstacle turn into concrete roadblocks. Proactive people prevent problems that are other would simply look back on in hindsight and claim unavoidable. The third P important is plan. Proactive people plan for the future. They avoid one step here and now and thinking instead look ahead and anticipate long-term consequences. Fourth P important is participate. Proactive people are not idle observers. They are active participants. In order to be proactive, you must get involved. You have to take initiative and be a part of the solution. The fifth P and the last important P is perform. Being proactive means taking timely, effective actions. You must be decisive and willing to do the work now to take ownership of your performance and hold yourself accountable. Thank you, and over to Parul.
I hope that presentation was informative to you. So at last, I would like to conclude that to be proactive, you should be able to take initiative. You should think of yourself as a responsible person of all the actions that you opt for. Do the right things without even asked or without even looking for. Choose your actions, attitudes, and moods, because it's the attitude you can control over yourself. It's the behavior that you choose, and you cannot control the situations that come in front of you. Never blame others for the wrong things that happen to you or the company.
Good evening, respected ma'am, and my dear friends. It gives me immense pleasure to stand before you all and discuss something very, very relevant. That is habit number 5. Seek to understand and then to be understood. As we all know that behind every effort, there's a motivation. And the same behind our effort is the very famous book of Stephen R. Covey on the 7 habits of effective person. Today, I, Srishti Sharma, along with my team members, present before you this habit and its importance in our day-to-day life. Only by listening sincerely, we will notice the true feelings and ideas of others. And to understand them, it's very necessary first to listen and then speak our words to them. All ears this side, please. We can practice this habit just now in next 10 to 15 minutes. First, you listen to us, understand us. We all have been to school 3 to 4 years back. Always we are taught how to listen, how to write, how to work. But we are not taught how to understand. This habit is very important in our life so as to understand others and give proper advice to one and all. Now, I want to call Ms. Shubhi Mishra to carry forward the presentation.
So guys, have you ever cared about listening? I guess no. Kuwe says, comparatively, a very few people have ever had been trained to listen. He further explains that first, seeking to understand has a great paradigm shift in it. We first want others to understand us rather than understanding what others want to say. We are either speaking or are preparing ourselves to speak. We always listen with the intention of either replying to the person or rather than thinking of what they are or rather than understanding what they want to say. Most often considering what the other person is saying only based on our own experiences and points of view. So, why people want you to listen? Listening is equally important part of communication just as writing and reading. People want us to listen so that we can understand what they want to say and convey, so that we can understand their emotions and thoughts. So that we can give them a constructive, so that we can give them constructive criticism, so that they can have a valuable feedback from us. Thinking logically, this is all what we want to have in a person whom we want to understand. So let us take a look on types of listening. On the basis of the types of listeners, the types of listening are classified into 5 major parts: ignoring, pretending, selective listening, attentive listening, and empathic listening. In ignoring, we really don't listen to the speaker what they are speaking and just ignore their words. In pretending, we just pretend that we are listening to the person who is speaking, but we are not listening them. In selective listening, we just listen to what the person is saying and whatever we want to listen through them. In attentive listening, we listen to the person attentively to each and every word of his. And in empathic listening, we just intend to understand what the other person is trying to say. So now I would like to call Siddharth Tomer for presenting the next.
A very good afternoon to everyone. I'd like to continue my presentation on my topic, and I'm presenting few of my slides. My slides is on roadblocks to listening and what not to do while listening. Roadblocks to listening are some of the problems that we face in our day-to-day life. While listening someone's presentation, attending some seminar. So few of points are spacing out, pretend listening, and selective listening. What is spacing out? Spacing out. Daydreaming can occur when a listener hears something that sets off a chain of unrelated thoughts in our head. Selective listening. This occurs when the listener thinks they have heard the main points or have got a great idea what a speaker wants to say and get distracted. Pretend listening, when we are not interested on someone's thoughts and get bored. So we are pretending that we are attending them faithfully so that he or she cannot be offended. That's called pretend attending. Now, what we do not do while listening to someone else. Few points are, evaluate, prop, interrupt, advise. Evaluate, we should not have a habit of giving our decision on a very early basis. We should always try to understand the situation completely and after that only decision should be given. What prop? Prop, your probing should not have been like so that the next person start feeling irritating and embarrassing. Whereas your probing should be like a conversation so that the next person while feeling comfortable with you and your personality. It should not be like a strict inquiry. Interpret. Mostly in our day-to-day life, we also try to see the things according to our experience. When we are happy, we feel the whole world is happy. So we do not interpret according to this. And the last one, advice. Before giving any advice, listen to the person next completely of any given decision by keeping yourself in his shoes, not on the basis of your personal experience. Thank you very much, and like to call Sujay Kumar. Thank you very much.
To understand is to feel what the other person is feeling and what he is thinking. There is a very good proverb we have used here, diagnose before you prescribe. Actually, we can see the analogy between treating a patient and communicating with people. In treating people, the doctor first runs some tests, he diagnoses the patient, and then prescribes the medicine, what is suitable for the patient. Similarly, in the communication, we first listen to the people. We understand their thoughts, what are their emotions behind those thoughts, and then we try to reply with the intent and accordingly. Covey has said about emphatic listening. Emphatic listening is a type of listening in which we think about what the other person is thinking. We put ourselves in the shoes of the other person and see the world according to his perspectives. When we do so, we create a win-win situation for both of us, because when we know what the other person wants from us and we already know what we want from the other person, we can combine both of them and we can create a win-win situation, which is very beneficial for both of us. So I will give some points. How can you practice the empathic listening? The first one is mirror the content. Mirroring the content actually is reflecting back what the speaker is saying. For example, a friend of you was saying like, my mother has cut off my pocket money. You can reply like, oh, why did she cut the pocket money? What were the reasons? So that you can engage him or her in a conversation and you can create a nested question association and you can understand each other better. The second one is reflecting on the feelings. As we all know that human is a social animal. We are the emotions and the feeling distinguish us from the other species. So the feelings are very important part. When talking to a person, we should reflect on the feelings. We should think about what are the emotions, what are the feelings that are related to his thoughts. If, for example, if someone is in an angry mood, we should try to calm him down. We should use a proper tone in which there is something soothing. So soothing, so we can help him with. If someone is depressed, we should try to give him confidence and boost off his confidence. We should be like cheerful, so he's comfortable with everything and he can get out of the depression zone. The third one is use open-ended question. All of you must remember the way back. Remember a time when you messaged your crush. It was a long paragraph. You wrote all of that, but you just got a reply like hum or k. You must have been very disappointing by this, like, why she replied like this. You should always use a open-ended question so that the people who is speaking can reply in a proper way, and that you can engage in the conversation and you can get to a point where you know each other very well. The fourth one is rephrasing the content. Rephrasing the content is in rephrasing the content, we mix the content like what comes first, what comes next. We just jumble the words and we form a sentence. As we talked about emphatic listening, I would like to show you a pie chart. The pie chart is basically shows just how important is the emotion and feeling when we are speaking. Only 7% of the communication process involves words. All other part, that is majority of the chunk of what we speak, how we speak, is actually how we present ourselves, that is body language. And the second major part is the feeling or the tone with which you speak. The major part we are focusing on is the feeling and emotion and the way you present yourself, so that the listener can understand you better. Here we can conclude with saying that we should listen with our eyes, our ears, our mind, and most importantly, our heart, because feelings are something that make a connection between the speaker and the listener. Now I would like to call Subhendu Devedi. He would tell us about how we can enrich the empathic listening. Thank you.
Now I am going to say about tips to enrich empathic listening. Can you please change the slide? Tips to enrich empathic listening. Let's keep that aside for a moment, as I'm going to share with you one of my personal events that shares me with this habit. One of my friends is the victim of my bad listening skill. Whenever we tried to begin a conversation, I always interrupted him, and our conversation was like, "Are tujhe pata hai? Haan, mujhe pata hai." Even I didn't know what he was going to say, or before he completed his sentence, "Are tune suna? Haan, maine suna." 99% of the time, I didn't have the slightest idea what he was going to talk about. He was so annoyed with it that he stopped sharing at all. So I worked on myself and became an empathic listener. So here I am with 4 tips which can enrich your empathic listening. First one of them is, don't try to fake your emotions. Please guys, if you are really listening, you don't need to fake your emotions. If the guy suspects that you're faking, then he won't share, you know. So stop doing that fake laugh and sympathy, guys. Next one is, pay attention to speaker. The speaker won't share his 100% if he realizes that you're not paying attention. Specifically at the beginning of the conversation, when he checks on your worthiness for the knowledge. Next one is, speak only if it is required. This is the important one. Your speaking must not obstruct the flow of communication and act as a deviation from the flow of relevant information. Next one is, try to dig deeply in his or her thoughts. The more you extract the information, the more you will be able to understand by it. So now, when I've enriched the listening skill, I will tell you about the benefits offered by empathic listening. First one of them is, Sujay, please. It reduces tension. Talking always relieves. Whether if someone is sharing his opinion, then it would also burst out your tension. Second one is, provokes the sensing of information. If the speaker gets to know that you're acting according to him or giving a reasonable response, then he will open up all about himself. Then you'll get to know more. Next one is, builds relationship of mutual trust and respect. Well, sharing and getting a good response in return allows the person to choose you as his trust buddy. He will also able to help you in future by listening to your problems. Next one is, enables the flow of emotions. Once the relationship of trust is established, the gate of emotions are open. The person will hold no barrier to outflow his emotions and tell you anything and share anything. So now I would like to call Utsav, which would continue the presentation.
According to Covey, If you listen, you become influenceable. And being influenceable is the key to influence others. This statement means that if you want to influence others, if you want others to influence, then this statement means that if you want someone, till now we have seen how to understand others. Now it's time that how to be understood. It is also important to understand. It requires consideration, seeking, and to be understood, it requires courage. But to achieve our goal, it requires both. Now, knowing how to be understood is a very important concept and important step to reach our goal. According to Greek philosophy, the ethos, pathos, and logos, which signifies, ethos signifies personal side, while pathos signifies emphatic side, and logos signifies the reasoning side. Many of us think that, many of us only care about the logical side of life, but are hardly care about the character and relationship with others. So if you seek to be understood, then you should be clear with your ideas, and the way of presenting should be a little bit different and simply effective and specific mainly. Now, I would like Sonali to continue.
What are the advantages of following this habit? First, a person is considered sincere. Being a sincere person means to be an active listener and to understand another's point of view. Second, is the task can be done effectively. If you first listen and then understand, there will be coordination among the members and the work would be done effectively. The third one is, it eliminates error. Error is the subject of misunderstanding of the result. If we first seek to understand, then to be understood, then the chances of error will be reduced. There are more number of job opportunities. If we first understand what the employer wants from us, then we will be able to make him understand our abilities, capabilities, our skills, and why should we be hired. There should be no conflict of interest. If we first seek to understand and then to be understood, we would know if we know the perspective of the speaker, we will know the win situation and we will try to make him understand. Now I will conclude with the presentation. Seeking to understand requires consideration. Seek to be understood requires courage. Seek first to understand, then to be understood is the principle for the effective communication. This habit is about communicating with others. It is about developing the habit of listening carefully and understanding the other person before giving your thoughts. Effective listening is not just simply echoing what the other person has said. Rather, it is putting oneself in the perspective of other person, listening empathetically for both feeling and meaning. This habit benefits us and it builds the trust and relation. It encourages us, it helps us in reducing tension. It will help us in becoming happy and successful. So I hope you will be practicing this life in your day-to-day life for being a highly effective people. Thank you, everybody.
You all must be thinking that we are gathered here for PTP session, which contains 25 marks of GP, isn't it? But the reality is that it all is going to help in our future or in our placement. We are going to face a problem, so we have to get ready, and we have to get ready before it occurs. So I, Kopal Gupta, with my colleague, Mr. Shatrughan Ocha,
Under the guidance of my PDP teacher, Ms. Suchi Agarwal, I chose a topic. PDP teacher, Ms. Suchi Rastogi, I chose a topic, how to say a habit number one, out of seven habits, be proactive, by Stephen Covey. So, before starting my presentation, the question occurs, what does proactive mean? So, before starting, I would like to share a video with you all.
Okay, and now let's see my task to resolve the issue. Okay, here's the first task to come to see what is better than
initiative. Sometimes around me things need to be done, I will volunteer. I will sincerely offer my talents and my help. I will try to be patient. So this is all the proactive means. Pro means before, active means doing something. Person or action creating or controlling a situation rather than just responding to it after it has happened is said to be proactive. Now, the difference between reactive and proactive. How does the reactive and proactive person behaves? Here we saw that the reactive person just reacted without analyzing a situation. Secondly, a proactive person first listens, analyzes, and then responds to the circumstances. Now, the leadership proactive. We all have heard the story of the ant and the grasshopper. So here, proactivity was present in ant. Of course, he knew himself, his potentials, his strengths. Moving towards one more example, if we lose in product, what we do? We start blaming raw material, government, workers, and all. But what does the proactive person do? He or she will get improvement in the product so that customer can't live without. Now the benefits of proactive instead of reactive. First one, saves time and money. Suppose you are putting in the work or effort, now you have to save time and money by preparing for the unexpected situations rather than reacting on that moment. Second one, alleviates problem or issues before they happen. You are able to uncover potential problem or conflicts. For instance, there are certain environment or people that you can't tolerate. So you minimize your contact with these people. Now the third one, recognize the need for change. As you are thinking ahead, you may realize there are things you could change for a better. Now, self-improvement and awareness. As you are contemplating the what ifs, you realize things about yourself. Now, seize the big picture and understand long-term goals. Acting proactively means looking ahead, you feel forward-looking. Clearer direction for your future. Sitting back and waiting for things to happen is not a solution. You are not in the position at work that you want today, but you know when you are planning to go, how you plan to get there. Now the last one, obviously peace of mind. You are happy with where you are and where you are going to be because you have an idea of what is coming. Now, thanks a lot for listening. Now, I'm going to hand over my presentation to Mr. Shatrughan Ojha.
Thank you, Kopal. Very delightful good evening to all my seniors and colleagues sitting out here. I am Shatrughan here. I will continue with the be proactive at work. Basically, these are five steps. The first one is predict. To do anything in the future, you should have a logical predictions. The second is prevent. To prevent unexpected problems. The third one is plan. Proactive people plan for better futures. Fourth one is participate. Taking part in every activity, is it not necessary? But if you are taking part, whichever you are interested, give your 100% efforts. Performance. Being proactive means taking timely, effective actions. So, here's your question. What do you want in your life? Anyone from the audience? Good. Anyone of this? Yeah. So, according to my point of view, the most common of things, happiness. Rich person. Success. Every human being is needs success. Good person. So, let's come to be proactive to seek placement and goals in a life by the following characteristics. So, what is the necessary conditions for that? Plan. The first one is plan. It is more important to know as much as you can about the companies and job applying for you. Punctuality. Being punctual is more important for a professional life. Process mapping, to make a list, what is your strongest point, what is your weakness, and do hard work for that. Put yourself forward. Always be first and face the challenge. Problem solve. To sort out the problems related to your placement. So, are you proactive? Anyone from the audience? Are you proactive? You think that you are proactive? So, ma'am, here a question for you.
How good are you at taking the initiative? How good are you at taking the initiative? And the second one, what tactics do you use to get things done? What do you how do you handle pressure and stress?
We all know what it means. It means to start, and with the end, we are pointing to an end goal or a desired goal. And from the mind, we all know it deals with the thinking part. Okay. So in order to make a real sense from these words, there is a need to integrate all these words. When we integrate these words, we get the definition of the begin with end in mind. What it means. It means to begin the each and every task by keeping the end goal in your mind. But what actually it means? It is clear from this that in order to complete any given task, whether it is a daily routine task or a bigger one, there are only two steps you have to follow. Number first step is of imagination. That what is your goal, what is desired goal, what you want to achieve in your life. First, you have to imagine, create a picture and a vision in your mind. And the second step is of creation, that you have to physically and mentally work on what you have imagined. Let us take the example of the freedom fighters. Okay, suppose Mangal Pandey, Bhagat Singh, Gandhi, what they had done. If we link this topic with our topic or presentation, so we can say that what they do, that they work in order to summarize in only two words. The first step is they imagine the picture of complete independence, Pun Swaraj and freedom. And the second work, they mentally and physically work on it. This is what we can say, what a begin with end in mind deals with. Now, it is not about all the step one and step two. The main idea is to integrate step one and step two. So how we can integrate these two steps? In order to integrate these steps, the step one, that is of imagination, and the second step, there is need of the other type of element. So let us take another example. Suppose you have to make a pizza. Okay, so what you mean to you needs one base other than is cheese, and the main task is to integrate both of these, and the integration is all depend on the temperature, the heat you provided in an oven. So let us assume that the first step, that is of imagination, is take it as a base of a pizza, and the second step is a cheese. So in order to integrate these all two steps, there is need of a temperature, and that element is none other than dedication. So here an image linked with a dedication part to a topic using this image. Here are you, and here is your desired goal, and you see there is a path between the both of these, and the path is made up of the puzzles. We all know this type of puzzle, we all played season 2. Here we see in between there is a gap, a piece of puzzle is not connected, and that piece of puzzle is in hand of this person. So what actually I'm trying to see here, that this which is a part of this person, it is actually a dedication, because it is all in your hand how to integrate the step one and step two. All is prepared, only you have to do is to dedicate your life, your soul, your time only to reach to your goal. Because without dedication, nothing is impossible. And the dedication in mind allows you not to fade your picture. The picture you imagine never get faded if you are always dedicated to your work. This is what begin with the end in mind means. Now, I am going to show you a video. So try to relate that video and the discussion I have given to you.
So leave it, guys. I'll take you to what the video is all about. The video was actually nothing but the trailer of Manji, the mountain man. So why we tried to put the video of Manji here? I don't think so it makes sense, but it actually does. Till now, Mohit explained about dedication, about goal, about setting goals, whatever it is. But most important of all these is dedication. Now, what Manji is about is that his wife dies because not getting medical supplies on time. So at this point, he's facing a humongous mountain, and he at that moment is broken, and that he imagines. This is the mountain because there is no way I can reach the hospital early, I could not save my wife. I will not let this happen to anyone else. So I will cut this mountain, I'll flatten it out. He dedicates his whole life to that idea, and he builds a road. What an excellent example of imagination that could be. So here I am back again, Avanshu, and I'll be talking about imagination. First of all, what is imagination? Imagination is nothing but your creative ability to transform images, ideas, and sensations in the mind without using your senses like hearing or listening. They are the same thing. So, Manji did an amazing job. Now here was Stephen Covey. He talked about imagination. What is imagination, guys? how does it happen? Like, are you like running? Like, I want to imagine something in my life. In first year, what happened to me? A friend asked me, "Hey, Namanshu, if you approach a girl, what are you going to say?" That point of time, I was blank. Why? Because I never imagined that. I thought, okay, it's simple. I'm cool with it. But that didn't happen. Why? Because I didn't imagine it. I failed terribly. That was my experience, leave it. Now, how does this imagination happen? You might also fail, but I don't want you guys to fail. How will you guys do imagination? Simple. You will not be running, or you will not be angry while doing imagination. Oh, I want to imagine right now. I want to imagine right now. You will not do this. You will be like sitting calmly on a Sunday night shower, hot shower. Yeah, it's happening. So it will happen automatically. You don't need to put an effort. Your mind be working, but physically you will be relaxed. So for being imaginative, you need to be a bit lazy. Lazy and restful, then imagination will happen. So that was imagination. Can I have next slide? Albert Einstein. What he is saying is, logic will get you from A to B, but imagination will take you everywhere. What is that everywhere? It can be the end of galaxy. It can be botanical garden. It can be anything, guys. It can be your life. It can be, what do you see it in your life? So most of the time, we do logic first. Okay, I'm going to approach a girl. Maybe I should wear this. Maybe I should, no, yes. And it doesn't go right. So logic is about yes and no's. How, when, it's all about yes and no's. But imagination is nothing, it's not like a question. It's not a question. Imagination is not a question. Imagination is imagination. It's an abstract thing. You cannot take it out of someone. It happens by itself. Now we know what's the difference between logic and imagination. You have the right tools to move forward. We have seen goal. We have seen the jigsaw puzzle. We have seen imagination. We have seen manji. We have seen logic. The next step, the most important part the logic plays, is about creating things. It tells about yes and no's. So let's move on to creation, guys.
So creation. The first thing that comes to our mind, it is that what does creation mean for and how it is related with the beginning in our mind. Begin with the end in our mind. So everything that happens in us in this world happens twice. The entire concept of creation is based on these two types of creation. The first is mental creation and the second one is physical creation. So mental creation is considered to be the first creation because this creation happens in our mind. We first think and then we execute. So all these things happen in our mind. It is also considered to be as a blueprint because we keep a mental vision, we create a mental vision for what we have to execute and what we have to do. Okay? Then it is also based on imagination and vision.
And then comes physical creation. Physical creation is known as a second creation as it starts after the mental creation. Then creation, it is also known as a creation which we execute. What we have planned in our mind, until we do it or execute it, it will be of no use. Therefore, physical creation is also known as a creation which we execute. Execution of the blueprint. Firstly, we make the blueprint and now we have to execute it. So this will come in the part of physical creation. It can also be seen as a life of contribution or fulfillment. Firstly, the mental creation made a statement that of fulfilling a statement or to achieve a dream. Physical creation was about contributing your efforts and making efforts to complete and fulfill it, and it is based on the physical work. Then the examples can be like mental creation, blueprint for a house, and its physical creation will be building the house. Firstly, you have to make a blueprint of a house, that's how your house will look like, and then the execution part will be your physical creation. Let us take the example of a business plan. For starting a business, we need a business plan. So it's not like 1 minute you are sitting in your classroom with a friend and saying like, "Hey dude, let's start a business." And the other minute, you are on the road setting up your business. It never happens like that. So you need to know that what kind of business you want to do, and you how much money you will be needing for your business, and what people will be your partner in your business. So we need plans for the business, and then afterwards we start the execution of that business, that in which city we want to execute the business or we want to start the business. Okay, so at the end, we can say that even after knowing all these things, that we all know the basic things that think before you do something. But then also we fail to apply these things in our daily lives. When it comes, like we are trying very hard, life throws at us many things that keeps us busy. So why don't we take a time and stop the thinking that whether these things will make us go towards our dream or will make us go away from our dreams. So for this, all we need is to have a clear understanding of our goal and do accordingly. So we need planning and then we have to execute it. So in very short line, in a single line, I can say that just begin with the end in your mind. Thank you.
Begin with the end in mind. The best example of this habit that can be inferred is that we can infer this from the life of a soldier. See how a soldier starts its life. Whenever he goes to a war, he keeps in mind that he has to win it. Or either he has to win it or either he has to die for his country. Okay. Then this is the best example, but we can infer from a soldier's life that whenever he goes to a war, he thinks as if what main thing comes to the mind of a soldier, that I want to be the first person to face the problem or I am going to be the last person to leave from my country. Okay, so from here we come to the last slide of our presentation. Here we come to the last of end of our presentation. What we inferred from it? We inferred from the from the presentation that everything in this world that you want to do, every task is created twice. First, we create it in our one mind. We create a result. What effect would it leave on ourselves, on our parents, on our environment? And then we create a plan according to it. After that comes the physical creation, which infers as the execution of the plan that we made in our mind. And both things are correlated. Everything has, both of the things have equal impact on our lives. Even if we lack in single thing, then we cannot achieve our results. Okay, so whenever you want to do any task, whether it is a small one or a big one, you have to make a plan according to it in your mind, and then you have to execute it to the fullest. So from here, I want to conclude my presentation, and thank you.
Mentioned that in your imagination section that listening and hearing are the same thing.
Yes.
But believe me, they are different things.
Yeah, closely they are same. Listening, okay, I am giving your attention. Hearing is just happening by itself. Listening is, okay, I am giving your attention. I am giving you my time. Okay. Imagination without logic. You can imagine all you want, but if you don't apply logic to it, it won't be of any help, right? So what is imagination without logic?
You see, the topic was divided into two parts. It was imagination, it was creation. So imagination, while I'm imagining, my imagination is supposed to be somehow be so good that it motivates myself. But I am motivated somehow connected to me. And I am imagining something that is worthwhile for my life. If I have decided something to come up with something worthwhile for my life, then I'll apply the logic. Manji applied the logic that I will cut the mountain. He couldn't go to the
that Munir ministry, he didn't ask them, okay, please come, people, please help us.
Actually,
make the
movie. The beginning of the movie, first tried to do that when they didn't help.
I didn't see it. But it didn't work out. It didn't work out. That was logic. It might work out, it might not work out.
As in the computer science engineer, how will this habit help me to work job in my to be computer science engineer? You are student of your computer science class.
Okay.
And you're saying that you may have to start, this is one of the seven habits of productivity, you have to start from the end of our mind, right?
Yes.
So, to become a good engineer in computer science domain, how can I start or from where I start?
Okay, first of all, you should be knowing that you are going to do a big job. If you are at a higher post like senior software engineers, it's going to be a lot of responsibilities on your shoulders. Like one wrong move can make anything wrong. You must have a motive first of all. First of all, even without going to imagination, you must have a motive that I want to help the society, I want to go someplace. Then only with that strong motive, then only you will imply the imagination, then only imagination will happen. That will help me because I'm knowing my responsibility. My path will be formed by that.
All the imagination will help me to achieve the career objective or to be there where I want to be. Or there's some other skills.
You will be sure about it, first of all. Second of all is your steps will be more responsible. You're not just going for it. One thing happened in the class with me. We were talking about Hyperloop. Anoop said to me, hey bro, let's do the Hyperloop. I saw that he is excited. Yes, he is doing the Hyperloop. On the other hand, Rohan said to me, bro, it's Hyperloop. Lives of people depends on us. If one piece of code goes wrong, all lives will be dead. Who will be responsible then? I will. So first, I need to be sure on my part.
Alright, I want to know how are you going to relate it with the real life world, with the corporate world? Levanshi, you're not answering.
Take somebody else answer the question.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, there are two steps to perform any task. Now, first, you have to imagine, you have to get the picture and vision in your mind. What is going to you have to do? And the second one is creation. So, whether it's a daily routine task, whether it's a bigger task, or you want to achieve something, anything.
Every company has a mission and vision. So, I'll take it as the end in the mind, right? You talk about mission and vision for the company, it's about beginning to the end in mind. Right, so how do you think your imagination, your creation, everything is going to fit in there?
And there are two types of people. Work as a company, for the company, by the company only. Their vision is company's vision. And some work for themselves, keeping the vision of the company in mind. They work on themselves, that they want to achieve, that's why they join the company. Some join the startup, some join other company in order what they want to achieve in their life. What is their primary goal?
what we want in the future, and we should work on our present. We should plan
we should plan according to what we are doing now. If we want to do something after 10 years, we want to see ourselves after 10 years, we have to check what we are doing now. And we have to plan from today. We have to plan our day-to-day lives according to that according to that position when what we want to see ourselves.
Thank you so much, guys.
Riya Singh, I'm a team member, Greta Jen. We are here to give you a presentation on Think Win-Win. So, actually, what is Think Win-Win? This is a type of habit, and this habit has been taken from a very reputed book, and the name is Seven Habits of Effective People, and this is written by the author, Stephen R. Covey. Actually, in this book, there are mentioned seven types of habits, and these habits are habit number one, be proactive, habit number two, begin with the end in mind. Habit number three, put first things first. Habit number four, think win-win. Habit number five is seek first to understand, then to be understood. Habit number six is synergy. And habit number seven is sharpen your saw. Let me just give you a brief introduction of what these habits are actually. You know, think, just saying, and you know, actually all these words have a different meaning as respect to what we think. So, habit number one, which was be proactive. It actually means that, I'll just brief up, it's actually you have the potential to take up your responsibilities. You don't blame your responsibility to others. Habit number two is begin with the end in mind, as our previous team explained beautifully. It's basically planning out your future with perspective in your mind. You have a goal, you have this planning, you have this blueprint. Habit number three is put first things first. We have multiple of things in our daily life. But make your priorities. The first priority, go for it. Then go for your second priority. Think win-win, which is our topic. Basically deals that how in your situation, when one competes or in a real life situation, how can you bring this winning feeling in both those situations? So think win-win, it basically deals with the situation where both the teams or parties wins. This will be further explained by multiple slides. Habit number five is seek first to understand, then to be understood. Basically, in our situation, what we do is basically we want others to listen to us first. But in this habit, it says that first listen to the other person and then try to put your points further. Habit number six is synergy. It basically tells that not always 1 + 1 = 2. 1 + 1 can be 4 also. It depends how motivated you are, how you put your energy into one. Habit number 7 is sharpen the saw. One simple quote by Abraham Lincoln, give me 6 hours to chop the tree and I'll spend 4 hours sharpening my saw. It basically, first plan your, whatever the goal it is, plan it. Plan it effectively. Get ready all the ingredients, whatever you want, and then go for it. So, now coming to our main presentation, that is habit number 4, think win-win. This will be explained in detail by my another teammate, and his name is Rahul. Thank you.
Today I'm gonna discuss the 4th extraordinary quality of a successful person. This is basically a different prospect of winning in which person A and B both are thinking of sharing mentality, both believe in sharing their experiences. Both believe sharing in their skills, both believe sharing in their learnings. They don't feel like if A is winning then I am B is losing, and they don't think B is winning then A is losing. Basically this is a type of mental competition. This is not a destructive competition. By adapting these qualities, we can develop three qualities in ourselves: integrity, maturity, abundance, mentality. Now come to the first, integrity. Integrity is a quality. This is somebody's ethics for his life. This is somebody's right understanding towards life. This is somebody's honesty towards his work. And second one is maturity. Maturity is like we don't fear to express our feelings to others. Uh, we
we have don't have debt have mentality that we will lose, that this is the only thing. We will mature that we believe on learning. And third one is abundance mentality. And this quality says that this is enough to learn. Not there are not two things that we win. This is not our purpose. By depth, these qualities we can develop these things in ourselves. We get confidence and we get motivation and we get respect from the society. For that, my friend, you know.
So, I mean, it was a lot type of lecture, right? So, let's call someone. Can anyone volunteer me? Anyone? I'll pick one up otherwise. Please, anyone? So we are in a room. Sir has offered us 100 rupees. Sir, he said that dividing yourself, however, I don't mind. What will you do? I mean, you need to think this women's situation and say that what will you do if you're having, think that you say, yes, I'm having this thing, women quality. What will you say? How will you distribute? 50-50. But now sir says, yes, sir gives me the authority that Ria, now you can distribute money. But you have the authority to say that it is a deal or it is a no deal. Okay? I say, okay, I'm saying that I'm a good person and taking 50 rupees, I'm giving you 50 rupees. It says a deal or no deal.
It's
agreement. Right? But I'm a better agreeing. Okay, I am taking 90 rupees. I'm giving you 10 rupees. Is it a deal or no deal?
No, it's cheating.
Cheating, right? See, this is, don't worry, this is the thing which 80% of us will say. Thank you, sir. Please be seated. So, actually, when he says it's a no deal, what will basically happen? He will end up getting no money, I will end up getting no money. He will also lose, I will also lose. So this is a lose-lose situation, not a win-win situation. Does win-win exist only when there's a 50-50% breakage? No. If he had been a person of thing win-win habit, if he had this habit, he'll say, I'll give the 10 rupees, it's a free money. It is a free money, I'll keep this 10 rupees. He is winning, might be this winning is less, but he is winning, right? And I'm winning too, I'm getting the 90 rupees. So, think win-win is not that everyone gets 50-50%. It's basically about how you think. You know, how much ever you get in your life, just grab it. It won't, like, it will go away if you don't grab this opportunity. So, when you inspire this win-win capability, what will happen? You'll have the ability to solve others' problem. You'll know that he's having this problem. I should solve it. My friend is in this need. And you will think about others' wants, what they want. You will be more perspective that, no, why should I think about myself instead? And you become kind to others. People will think that this person is so good.
Discussing the various types of attitude in a person. There are five types of attitude. Win-win, win-lose, lose-win, lose-lose, and deal. It's a deal. Deal is a situation in which both the parties are at mutual agreement. Hence, deal is it in which no win and no lose situation occurs. The next attitude comes when one loses and the other loses too. It is not beneficial. Beneficial attitude does not occur. Hence, no one wins and no one loses. This is lose-lose. A win-win situation arises when both the parties understand that they have won the situation. No matter what has been the result, they believe that there is enough for everyone. These are people with win-win attitude. To explain the next attitude, we have taken an example of court where two people are to be witnessed. The one who accepts is a criminal is sentenced to jail and hence loses, while the other who does not accept the crime is innocent and is set free and hence wins. This creates a situation of lose-win. A win-lose is a situation reverse of lose-win, where in which the first person does not accept the crime but the other one does. Then the first person wins, that is set free, while the other loses and has to live in a jail. Thank you for your precious time.
After this video, you might have got to know that the main, you know, the difference which we get confused is lose, win, win, lose, lose, lose. So what we saw, like lose, lose and win, win situation was just explained by my friend, and deal also. But when it comes to lose, win and win, win, lose, that's the situation which we come across most frequently. It's basically like we are in a competition, one loses, one wins, and this situation is a required one. We cannot say that one attitude is bad or other is too. Both have all have their significances, and with this I would like to conclude my presentation that please think win-win and make this place a better place to live. Thank you. Yes sir, it helps in both personal life as well as in professional life. An example of professional life was just given by me, that whenever we have like, let me take something which from my own classroom itself. I have a friend. Let me take an example of Rajat itself. I know something in my subjects and he doesn't understand. A person who doesn't has this habit, he will think that there isn't plenty in the world, and what I'll do, I'll not explain him. He comes to me, he says that, do you know this answer? I'll not explain him because I'm a lose-win person. I don't want to lose. I'll think that he'll not. But what will happen is, if I'm a think win-win person, I'll explain him. The result might be anything. Might fail or he might pass. But what will happen? My knowledge will be doubled. Anyone who possesses this think win-win capability, his knowledge, his attitude, his personality gets developed. We get respected in the society. And I think so, being respected, being loved, is the most important aspect for which we live in our real life situation. Talking about professional life, in the personal life, as we said that we are getting free money. So I think so, it was a situation where we should grab these opportunities. Be it 10 rupees, I go and have a biscuit, but that's free. So whenever we get, there's always an advantage of this, because somewhere or the other, you will always gain. And when you believe in the situation of lose-lose or lose-win or any other thing, dealing 50-50%, but in the next situation, what will happen? But in this situation, you'll always gain. Gaining is the point, and everyone lives here to gain. So basically, think win-win does happens between two person. It requires two person to have this capability, because even if I will have this win-win capability, then if I would have been the other person, I will say, okay, give me 10 rupees, I'm fine with it. But if the reverse situation occurs, it is a requirement, sir. Yes, ma'am, it will be. Ma'am, because working overtime, I'll improve my experience, I'll improve the working capability of my technologies. For example, if I'm in electronics department, I'll be given circuits to work on. I'll work on circuits. I think so, ma'am, I will do it. Ma'am, I'll get promotion, ma'am, because my boss will see, yes, she's working hard, and anyone who works hard, now it depends on my boss too, ma'am. If he sees, ma'am, if you see me working without any rewards, you will give me attendance, because you will see that, yes, ye ladki kaam karti hai, she works hard. Ma'am, that is not partiality. If I'm working, if I'm doing work, and without any ifs and buts, there will be a situation where if I'm needing help, if I'll be there, if you need help, I'm being there without any questions.
Know it or not, it is carefully designed by you. The choices, after all, are yours. You choose happiness, you choose sadness, You choose failure, you choose courage, you choose fear. Just remember that every moment, every situation provides a new choice. And in doing so, it gives you a perfect opportunity to do things differently to produce more positive result. Hello and good morning, everybody. So let me introduce you to the team of presenters which I have. Kushagra Verma, Mayank Motwani, Mohammed Adnan, Mohammed Habib Ansari, Anas Qureshi, Mohammed Rizwan, Mohinderpal. So guys, to begin with, let's imagine a situation. You are working in a team of four in a particular project, and you realize you're working in a team of four with on a particular project, and you have to... You're working in a team of four on a particular project. You have to give it on a deadline. You realize that you have done all your work, you have put in all your efforts. And on the day of deadline, you realize that your project has been rejected. And that's not because of you. That's because of your teammate who has not done his efforts. Now, what would you do? You would ideally or naturally, everybody would be aggressive. Some of you might get violent, a few might get upset. But what ideally a proactive person would do. But before going to that part, what a proactive means, we would get to the point that what a proactive actually means.
Proactive behavior includes acting in advance of a future situation rather than just reacting. It means checking control and making things happen rather than just adjusting to a situation and waiting for something to happen. Proactive people don't blame others on something that they have to, that someone will be responsible for their work, and they are responsible for their own behavior. They don't depend on circumstances, genetics, and conditions. Proactive behavior can be compared with other business-related behaviors such as proficiency and adaptability. Proficiency, which is fulfillment of one's job, and adaptability, that is response to change. And proactive, which means initiate to a work. So let's discuss about reactive versus proactive.
Morning, everyone. Now, I myself, Kushagra Verma, and my teammate Rizwan will be talking about reactive and a proactive person. So we will understand the difference in the mindset of a reactive and a proactive person. But before moving on to that, we must understand who a reactive person is. A reactive person is the one who is largely affected by the surroundings around him. A person who changes his decisions or makes his new decisions on the basis of his surrounding or the actions surrounding him. For example, if I am coming to my class before, I'm a football fan of Arsenal. Say if my team loses this morning and I have to go to the class the very next hour and I'm upset. I don't talk to my friend, I don't perform well in the class, that will be the reactive behavior of mine. So talking about some recent examples, we know recently Mahendra Singh Dhoni, a former team captain, gave up his captaincy on all cricket formats. Now Virat Kohli is our new captain. So when we judge the two captains that we have had, we can purely see the different proactive and reactive side of them. When we see or analyze Virat Kohli, we can see his reactions on the field and off the field in every game. That basically shows the reactive side of a captain, of a person. But whereas we all know, if we compare him to Mahendra Singh Dhoni, who was very well composed in his time, and he never showed it on the field, his reactions, what he's thinking, he was well composed off the field and on the field. Now, we all know that the two movies got released, Kabil and Rais, at the same time. There was some huge conflict between the fans, the SRK fans and the Hrithik fans. They basically were not promoting the other movies, they were mainly following blindly following their actors. So here, when Hrithik Roshan, in all this, Hrithik Roshan, he basically tweeted accepting SRK as his mentor, and he congratulated him for the movie, and he accepted that in a way SRK was better, and he was no doubt for his follower, and he is improving at every level. That in between all these conflicts shows a proactive person, that is him being accepting his performances and congratulating others.
Recently in Rajasthan, Sanjay Leela Bhansali was attacked by Rajput because of some script of the movies. That was the reactive reaction of people. And Sushant Singh Rajput gave up his surname. That was also considered as a reactive reaction. So now we suppose one person is reading a book which is not of his syllabus. So a reactive person think that why I am reading this, it's a waste of time. But a proactive person will read it, and at least he think he will need to learn, he will get to learn something new. That was the difference between the reactive and the proactive.
Now we all know the difference between reactive and proactive person. You people are the better judge. Now we will explain you how to be a proactive person, as it is the positive side according to us.
Hello, I am Mohammed Adnan. I'm here to discuss about the fact that how you can be proactive. So in order to be proactive, the first thing you have to do is you have to choose the area you want to be good at. First of all, you have to choose the area in which you have to be proactive. Then you have to follow the couple of rules. For example, first of all, you have to set goals. In order to be proactive, first of all, you have to set goals in which you have to be sure of what are the things you are going to do, and you have to respect and acknowledge those goals. Second point is ask yourself why. You have to ask yourself why you are going to achieve that goal. It should not be under the pressure of someone else. It should not be to make someone happy, but it should be rather to make yourself happy and satisfied. Because ultimately, at the end, it is you who are going to be going through all the circumstances and bad things accomplished. If things don't work out, for example, if you are achieving the goal and perhaps due to some circumstances, you are not able to achieve those goals, there should be a backup plan as well. You should not leave those goals and move to some other goals, but you should stay on those goals for a particular time, and you should wait for the good things to happen. Plan and visualize. These are the two topics. First is the plan, in which in the planning version, you have to plan the goal which you are going to achieve. Planning in those goals should not be affected by any circumstances, rather good or bad. And the second point is to visualize those goals. Once you have created once you have planned those goals, you have to visualize those goals. You have to keep on reminding yourself that you have seen those goals, you have made have you ever made progress regarding those goals or not. Last one topic is the own it. All the bad circumstances which are the outcomes of those goals, you should be accepting that. You should not blame those things on other person. You should be courageous enough to accept those facts. And apart from these things, there is one more thing, that we are human beings, and we are bound to make bad things. If we are bound to make mistakes, that doesn't mean you are behaving non-proactive. It is natural to behave against being proactive, because in the long term we have seen many people, they are quite famous, but they are not able to control their being proactiveness.
Good morning, everyone. Myself, Anas, is here to tell you what importance of being proactive. Well, we all know that we face different problems in our life, so it is very important for us to be proactive. First is to find the better solution to any problem. We should always focus on finding the solution. Suppose we are stuck in a problem, so we should focus on we can control, not on things that we cannot control. So if we are focusing on things we can control with the final outcome, we will definitely get a good result. The second point is your positivity level increases if you are proactive. It means that you should always set your milestones in a specific time frames to achieve your goals. It will increase your positivity level in every area you are. And the next point is it also increases your confidence level as you are doing taking small steps every day to be better who you are yesterday. So it increases your confidence, increases your planning ability. You should always have a contingency plan. It is a set of procedures in which if there is an unplanned disruption, so you can handle the critical events and recover the organization. If you are proactive, the probability of failure decreases.
Hello, this is Habib Ansari. Till now we have seen what is being proactive, what actually proactiveness means, what is the difference between being proactive and being reactive, and what is the importance of being proactive. So now let's see how to implement this proactiveness in a real life. So there are basically four steps in which you can implement proactiveness in your real life. So first step is stop. Stop. This will give you some time to think and analyze the situation. Think before you do anything. The second step is think. Think before you do anything. Think what the situation is. Think about what you are going to do, how it will affect the other person. We move to the next step, which is analyze. Analyze the situation in which you are. Analyze what your actions will bring the future. What will be the outcomes of your reactions? The last step is react. Once you think and analyze the situation you are in, you will get a better perspective of the situation. You will get to know how to react in the situation so that you can get a better outcome. So these are the basic four steps in which you can implement proactiveness in your real life. My friend Mansi gave you a situation in which you were in a team of four, active on a project, and you got to know on the last date that your project has been rejected. And it was not because of you, it was because of one of your members. So let's just implement these four steps in that case. Stop. Stop before you do anything. Stop before thinking what the person is in. Think what the situation might have been. Think why the person has not done his work. Analyze what you are going to do. Analyze what will you do. Analyze what will it affect. How it will affect the situation. React. Now is the time to react. Now you have to do. What will you say to the person? How will you deal the situation? How will you encourage the team further? So I would like to call Mohinder to conclude this presentation.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am here, Rohan, and with my teammates, I am going to put forward a most important habit from the 7 habits of most influential people, that is, seek to understand first, then to be understood. So we will be walking in this presentation through various aspects. We will be seeing a real life incident. Further moving, we will be analyzing the situation, what actually went wrong over there at that point of time. We have some statistical data from the industries, and we will then try to understand what are the things that we do wrong and what we should do and what we should not do. Further, we will go through a session of HR questions, and we will be reviewing the HR questions, what HR actually expects from us while he's interviewing a person. Okay? So, moving forward, give a huge round of applause and let's get started.
All right, sir. We'll try to provide you with the best output.
one, ma'am.
This is the SRS documentation sheet of our customer. Read it thoroughly.
Oh, I know exactly what this customer wants. I have worked on a similar project before.
Hello?
Hello?
Am I talking to the CEO of the company?
Yes.
I have some issues. Where is the GPS feature of the app? I don't trust you guys.
But sir, listen to me, sir. Sir.
Sorry, ma'am. I apologize.
Your call is not of such a potential kind. Just because of your poor listening.
I would never repeat it again.
You need to understand first if you want yourself to be understood. We're done with you. You're fired.
My name is Rahul Srivastav. Let's get straight to the point. Where did the deal went wrong? The client gives an order to the company expecting a complete feature-filled app. The CEO of the company tries to explain the requirements of the client to the project manager. Everything is going great up to this point. The project manager starts hearing when he hears the CEO, he starts relating what he is hearing through his previous work experiences, his frame of reference. Then consequently, he decides prematurely what the CEO is trying to say without actually listening to the CEO. This is the point where miscommunication took place. So, since the project manager did not understand the CEO, how could he get himself to be understood by his team members? This leads to an important feature getting missed from the app. And then the obvious happens. The client loses his faith into the company, and then he closes the current deal as well as the future deals. And consequently, this led to the expulsion of the project manager. This is just a small example of to what extent things can go wrong just because of a common habit of listening with the intent to reply and not with the intent to understand. Now, my fellow team member will explain to you the real facts and figures.
Hello everyone, my name is Sachin Kumar. Let's have a look at five poor listening skills. So the first point is pretend listening, in which you pretend that you are actually listening to the actually what someone is saying, but you still ignore what.
Thank you, Sachin. In the earlier slide, he explained the listening problems, what are the barriers to the listening. I am myself Rahul Kumar Rai. Yeah. So I am here to explain the points how to overcome poor listening. The first problem was the prejudice. So prejudice is a state of mind, pre-assumed state of mind or preconceived opinion of feeling, which is generally irrational. For example, let us suppose I am here on behalf of the BJP party to explain the feelings, to explain the ideology and beliefs of the party. So suddenly and generally there is a presumptions regarding the BJP workers that, oh, he is from BJP, so certainly he is going to speak on the Ram Mandir and the second one is Hinduism. So this is the pre-assumed state of mind. So this gives birth to the two things. The first one is ignorance. And so we can overcome with these situations by following the two points. First one is make conscious efforts to take charge of your thoughts. And the second one is consciously avoid taking an I know what he or she means the speaker is going to speak. And in the similar way, the second problem was distractions. So distractions are of mainly four types. The first one, physical, mental, and the third one is visual, fourth one is auditorial problem. So mainly I will focus on the first and second, mental and the physical. So distractions. So first, to avoid the distractions, the first step is we face the speaker, and second one is we maintain eye-to-eye contact with the speaker. This eye-to-eye contact creates a process of synchronization. And the second, mouth is quiet. And fourth,
hands are still, feet are still, ears listen carefully, etc. And the third point is paying attention. In this situation, the listener is facing towards the speaker, even he is maintaining eye-to-eye contact, but he is only hearing, not the listening. So this problem, we can overcome with this problem by taking notes while listening to the speakers. And the fourth one is fear. Fear is a great barrier to the communication. We can come out of the fear. Whenever we're trapped in the fear, we can come out of fear by achieving the state of mind, of state, calm state of mind. And this can be instantly can be achieved by taking a deep breath. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Rishabh Singh. Following are the actions that can be taken in order to practice habit 5, that is, seek to understand, then to be understood. And the first point is, stand in their shoes, to see or understand someone else's position or perspective. And the second point is genuine listening. Genuine listening means suspending memory, desire, and judgment, and for a moment at least, understanding the other person. As a matter of fact, genuine listening is composed of 53% of body language, 40% feeling, and 7% of words only. And the third point is practice mirroring. Before we practice mirroring, we need to understand mirroring. What is mirroring? Mirroring is the behavior in which one person subconsciously imitates the gesture, speech pattern, or attitude of other. Basically, mirroring is understanding the other person's viewpoint. And the last and fourth point is listen with your ears, hearts, and eyes all open. Now, my fellow mate Rahul Padhyay will tell you about the benefits of these actions.
Thank you, Rishabh. My name is Rahul Upadhyay, and I am going to discuss the benefits of the actions taken. So I'm starting with point one, better understanding. So having a clear knowledge about the facts, we can understand the problem much better. Coming to my second point, growth in efficiency and high productivity. Efficiency means doing a work with a minimum amount of material used, with minimum energy and time, all right? Coming to my third point, improved intellectual and situation handling skills. Intellectual qualities can be developed by experience. Experience can be gained by listening and understanding the people around us. On the other hand, experience will help us to situation handle. Because situations experience is nothing else. I'm coming on the next point, lesser conflicts and more of project growth. When we understand our surrounding and the people much more, then we get insight of their behaviors. So there must be so much less conflict, and it helps to more of the project growth. Coming to my next point, overall growth. By the overall growth, I'm talking about the social, economic, and social, economic, and self-growth. Social growth is nothing but interaction with the people around yourself. And with economic, I would like to discuss economic. Economic is nothing but working under a team which is going to do efficient work. Combination of these social and economic growth leads to the peace, which further comes as self-growth. Okay, thank you. Now I'd like to invite my friend Ritu for the next slide.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Ritu Singh. You seek to understand first, then to be understood. This phrase has its uses and effects on professional aspects too. The question is how we as engineers or other professionals can incorporate this in our life. The answer is much simpler than what we think. Number one, take feedback. It doesn't matter if you're an employee of a company or a CEO, taking feedback and trying to understand them will always help you in both your personal professional growth as well as company's growth. Number two, be a bit cautious. In professional life, it is very important what you say and what you're trying to make the people understand should always occur same. Always remain thoughtful, alert, and careful of the possible problems, or rather, remain a bit cautious. SRS, Software Requirement Specification. It has to be understood correctly and clearly, then has to be made other members of the project team understood.
Amazing guys, you have done a great job. Give a huge round of applause for these guys, please. Motivate them, please. Okay, cool. The overall, we have just seen the slides, we have got the entire concept, what we should do, what we should not do. Moreover, we should basically understand God has given us two eyes and two ears to perceive more, to analyze more the things, and one mouth to deliver the thing which is analyzed via your intellect. Use your intellect while you are dealing with any situation. That is all what this habit means. So during an HR interview, the HR only tries to get these aspects. He wants to check these skills. How good are you at understanding the questions? How good are you understanding the situation and handling it in a more effective way? So without wasting any time, just move forward towards the HR questions. These are the HR questions, the 10 HR questions which actually judges what kind of a person you are. So let's quickly go through these. Describe a bad experience you had working with your ex-employer. And second one, describe how you disagreements. Explain a situation when you explained a complex idea simply. Describe when you had adapt to change at work. These are the 10 questions which are basically asked by HRs during interview sessions, which are actually to judge what kind of person you are, how comfortable and calm you are while dealing with such situations, and how maturely you act. If you are at the post of public relations, the calmness, composed, even in hardest situation is the most important thing. You are trying to serve a customer, and this is the skill that you definitely need to have. So, signing off, this was Rohan Joshi for you and my teammates. Again, great work done. Thank you.
To this line, we all expect an introduction like, hi, I'm Shivani, and I'm with my fellow mates, so and so and so. But I'm not going to do that, because I also know that you don't want to hear that. You all know me. So this is what our next habit, think win-win, is. You do not do what is not comfortable with the other one. It is a habit of mutual benefit. It respects the mutual feelings of everyone involved in the work you are doing. Now, we all share the lunch we get to college. We all do that. But suppose if you have a pizza in front of you, 6 slices nicely cut, you order it all for yourself, and then suddenly all of your friends appear to share that slices of pizzas. Will you be willing to share that? I don't think so. Anyone would do that. So here the concept of the habit think win-win comes. You do what is beneficial and what is satisfactory to everyone around you. Like if you do not share those slices of pizzas with your friend, you may lose your friend or someone may feel bad. But if you do, everyone will be able to taste that pizza and everyone would be very happy with you and your friendship. So this is what we will be talking about. So now I, Shivani Gupta, with my fellow mates, welcome you all to have a great discussion about the topic, think win-win. I would welcome my friend to talk further about the topic.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Shubham Poswal, and win-lose the totem pole syndrome. Let's just take an example to understand this thing, because that will be an easy way to just make it clear. Let's just think there are two persons, A and B, and A is having a car which he wants to sell, and another person, B, is a person who is able to get that car, and he bought that car from A at a huge amount of 5 lakh rupees. Now, after some day, when he uses this, he discovers that the car is in in a very critical situ- it is in very critical situation. That's not been a good average. That's working not at good at all. So he calls back A and he tells him that just give me my rupees and take your car. But A refuses to give that. So that's the whole scenario of a win-lose situation. Because here is one thing, one person A who got 5 lakh of rupees, that is a winning scenario. And another person B who got a car, which is a just a crap. So that's a losing situation. Win-lose situation is also known as zero-sum situation. Essentially, there is no any single values that can be included in whole the scenario in both the parties. Because just taken, there are, if we are in the situation of win-losing, then what happens, there are the two feelings that emerges out. First is positivity and another is negativity. Positivity is from the winning side and negativity is from the losing side. Now, what it does, if win-lose ensures you that you are going to make your relations bad with the another person who is going to lose. If you have won, that doesn't mean that you have won it totally, because it may have hurt the another person so badly that your relations are going to be ruined. Now, in win-lose situation, there is by definition, there's a one winning team and another is a losing team. So what win-lose situation does, the person who is winning, if he is not concerning with the feelings of the other person who is going to lose, then it's not be a good thing, because he is imposing his feelings on the other. He's just imposing his behavior on the other person who is losing. So there's a win-lose totem pole syndrome. Now I would like to call my next friend, that is Shrey Sharma.
Thank you, Shubham. My name is Shrey Sharma, and I would like to talk about the topic lose-win. So what does it mean? It means that I lose for you to win. When you do something unwillingly, just because someone told you to, it's a lose-win situation. It looks prettier on the surface, but it's just as dangerous as a win-lose situation. It is also called the doormat syndrome, since you are basically acting as a doormat and letting others take advantage of you. If you adopt lose-win as your basic attitude towards life, people will wipe their feet on you. You will be the nice guy given, all in the name of being the peacemaker. You may give into peer pressure, allow others to take advantage of you, and hide your true feelings deep inside. A typical example of losing situation is, as you lose weight, you lose your baggy clothes. But instead of selling them and making some money, you give it to the poor and needy. So you lose money, but the poor gain from your loss. Of course, it is okay to give in at times when you feel that the issue is not important and the decision is not going to hurt you or any of your friends and people around you. However, it is important that you take stand when you feel that the issue is related to you and it's going to hurt people around you or maybe you. Next, I would like to call upon stage my friend Shivansh Tomar, and he would like to tell you about the topic lose-lose.
Thank you, Shwe, for inviting me. My topic is lose-lose situation. Lose-lose situation is that in which person has choices, but no choices leads to net gain. Lose situation is also known as no-win situation. War is a perfect example of lose-lose situation, because war leads to deaths and injury of lots of people, poverty and loss of productivity, loss of economy, etc. Revenge is also a good example of lose-lose situation. By getting revenge, you may think you are winning, but actually you are really hurting yourself. According to game theory, lose-lose situation is that in which no player get benefit from outcome. Now I am handed over to Srishti Chaudhary. She is going
going to tell you about.
Thank you, Shivansh. Now I'm going to discuss about win-win situation. To understand this situation, first let's hear a story. There were two friends, two best friend I would say, and they were a good football player. Once there was an international match and one friend gets to goal, so as much as goal, and he wins the praises of everyone in his team. The other friend gets jealous of him, and he passes the less whenever he gets the chance. He never passes the ball to him. Because of this, there was lack in team coordination, and they loses the match. The other friend, who was good in playing the match, he discusses this situation with his father, and his father, after listening the whole situation, only tells one thing: whenever you get a chance, my child, pass the ball to your friend and see what happens. First of all, he thinks that what a rubbish idea he has given to me. I will never consider that. But on the final match, he decided, let's give a try. He is my father and I should listen to him. And when he get the opportunity to play with the ball, he passed the ball to his friend. His friend was at once shocked with him. Why is passing the ball to me? He is a good player. I'm sure he will make the goal. Why is he passing to me? But after some time, when he repeats the activity for three or four times, he was little reluctant at first, but then he thought, okay, if he is giving me chance to make a goal, if he is giving me an opportunity, I will also do the same with him. And he started passing the ball to him. And with this, there was coordination in them, and the team wins. And this is how a win-win scenario was witnessed, and everyone was happy. So at the end of this, their friendship also retained, and the team was also got to win the match. So this was the basic fact was what win-win is and what it can bring to us. Now, what are the attitudes of win-win? The person who seeks for win-win basically looks for three attitudes, or he have the three attitudes. First one is integrity. Integrity means he have to be sure about his thoughts, his ideas, and he have to listen what he wants for himself. Second one is maturity. Maturity is not about telling what you want. It's also about considering what other wants from you, and also think about them and what the situation they want from you. And the last one is abundant mentality. It's about thinking that there is plenty for everyone, and we all can achieve a win-win situation. Now that's all. And and the extension of win-win, that is how to think win-win, will be explained by my fellow mate Shubham Vats.
Thank you, Shishti. I will tell you more about how to think win-win and how to implement it. Before you will ever win the race in the public area of your life, you must first win the private life, private battle with yourself. All changes begins with you. What are your insecurities? Everyone has an insecurity. Try to find out and remove it. If you are extremely insecure, then it is very difficult to think win-win.
Thank you, Shubham. Myself, Shubham Pathak. As for the conclusion point of view, my slide suggests the topic, the fruits of win-win spirit. Before starting it, I would like to put on a point in front of you all. We as a mankind have known the meaning of development and prosperity, all this stuff, from such a long time. But we are not able to achieve it properly. By means of development, we understand as our self-development, but it is not what it means. Development means development as a whole, till the highest level. So, which states our topic, think win-win. Think win-win helps individuals to grow till the topmost level of the society, by which we can take benefits from different aspects, from every action we take. For example, if you are working in a